I'm Sarah Puccini. I'm the Assistant Director of the Lackawanna Historical Society. Thank you again for tuning in and joining us in our Friday Zoom lectures as we continue to all work from home. We're joined today by our friend Stephanie Longo, who joined us in April to talk about Italian festivals in Lackawanna County. We would have been celebrating one of those this weekend. It would have been St. Ubaldo Day in Jessup, but like so many other things, it's been kind of canceled for the year, unfortunately. So today, Stephanie will be joining us to talk about Sylvester Poli. You may remember going to the Ritz or the Cumberford in Scranton. It had its birth with Poli at the turn of the century. So I will turn it over to Stephanie, and any questions may hold them until the end. Stephanie?
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for coming today. I'm really excited to give this presentation because Sylvester is my unsung Italian-American hero / Italian-American obsession right now, because now that I've discovered who he is, I want to find out everything there is to know about him. So I crammed a lot of stuff into this presentation, and I hope that you enjoy it. So this presentation is called Sylvester Poli, A Builder of Palaces. And as you will see, the palace theme is something that plays a lot through Poli's career. It plays a lot through the names of his theaters that he built. So that is the reason why I gave the presentation this title. And of course, the number one question I'm asked when I talk about Sylvester Poli is, who was he? So the elevator pitch version of who was Sylvester Poli was that he is a theater magnate, and I credit him with revolutionizing the American theater industry. What we see today when we go to the movies, when we're able to go to the movies, would not be possible without Sylvester Poli. So when you think about some of those memories that you have, maybe like Marianne and Sarah were saying, when you went to the Cumberford or the Ritz in childhood, you would never have had those memories if it wasn't for Sylvester Poli. So let's get started. Sylvester was born on December 31st, 1858 in a town called Bolognana, which is near Lucca, Italy. And Sylvester's story itself is actually very unique, as you'll see, in terms of Italian immigration, because Lucca, Italy is actually up north in northern Italy. And a lot of times we talk about Italian immigration to the United States, we talk about southern Italian immigration. Most people, my family included, came from southern Italy, so the area below Rome. Sylvester actually came from above Rome, and you could see a picture of Bolognana below. One of his jokes, because as you could see, he was born on New Year's Eve, was that he was a year old 2 hours after he was born because of the time that he was born. His story is the true immigrant story. He came from nothing and he was able to make himself into a millionaire. And this town that you see right there with that beautiful green, that's where it all began for him. So over the course of his life, Sylvester Poli owned and operated approximately 30 theaters in the Northeastern United States and in Washington, DC. And the one that you see right there is Poli's Majestic Theater in Bridgeport, Connecticut. This was one of his later theaters, but I chose it as a nice example of his buildings because it was designed by Thomas W. Lamb. He was an internationally known architect who was considered the foremost theater and cinema architect of his era. He designed a lot of buildings for Sylvester Poli, and he designed Madison Square Garden in New York, and the adjoining to this theater was Poli's Palace, so there were actually two theaters in the same complex, and both Poli's Majestic and Poli's Palace are abandoned today. The Majestic still stands, it's vacant, and as you can see, it's being used as a storage space. And the city of Bridgeport is looking for a developer to take over the complex and to restore it to its former grandeur. The former Savoy Hotel is also on this 13-acre complex. And that curtain that you see, I'm gonna just zoom in a little bit, is estimated to be worth more than $1 million. They can't get it out of there because if they try to get it out, it's going to fall apart. So they're really trying to find somebody who's going to respect the historic significance of this and the worth of that beautiful curtain and try to make it into like a living museum for Sylvester Poli. So everybody asks me when I talk about Sylvester, how on earth did you get involved with something like this? Because it's definitely not what you're used to hearing from me about Italian American history. So last year I was part of a wonderful program, Leadership Lackawanna. I was part of the core program of Leadership. Leadership is an amazing organization here in Northeastern Pennsylvania. And The CORE program is a 9-month program where business professionals in the area get to have, among other things, wonderful leadership training, as well as a service project for the area. And we were assigned to do a historic display in the Ritz Theater. The Creative and Performing Arts Academy in Northeastern Pennsylvania asked for this, and we ended up doing it. And that's how I discovered Sylvester Poli. I had no idea about him because he really is an unsung Italian American hero. And here's this amazing Italian American history in my own backyard. And here's our team on graduation day from Leadership Lackawanna. I have to give them a plug. It was a life-changing experience. So if anybody here on this call is interested in participating in CORE, if you go to leadershiplackawanna.com, CORE program applications are available right now. And I strongly suggest applying for it. It is life-changing. So definitely wanted to make sure that I gave them a bit of a shout out in this presentation. And of course, as I said, we did the Ritz Theater in downtown Scranton. And those of us that are on this call that are from the area, we know and love this building. But I want you to take note of that white part behind. That white part behind is actually part of Sylvester Poli's original building that was there. You'll see later on in the presentation what the actual building looked like. But when the Comerford chain took this over and completely gutted and redid it, they redid the front facade, but the back of it is still the original building. And if you go into like the inner bowels of the building, you could actually see where the old building ends and the new building begins. It's pretty cool in there. All this research just really led to more questions about Sylvester Poli beyond what we put in the exhibit that's in the Ritz Theater building. And the cool thing was he got a start in wax. I mean, how do you go from being a wax sculptor to this theater magnet? So we'll talk a little bit about that right now. As I said, he was born in Bolognana and he was illiterate until he came to the United States, but he enjoyed sketching as a child. During the Franco-Prussian War, his family provided refuge to a Monsieur Dublé. He was a noted French sculptor of his era, and he's the one who taught Sylvester Poli how to create clay and wax sculptures. So Sylvester went around town in Bolognana selling these sculptures for food. And after the war, Monsieur Dublé invited the 13-year-old Sylvester Poli back to France to be his apprentice. And he returned to Italy just to complete his compulsory military service. That is something that Italian law does require of all citizens, all male citizens. He went back to France to resume his studies, and then he took a job with the Musée Grévin in Paris. And here's the Musée Grévin. So the best way to describe this museum is like the French version of Madame Tussauds. It was actually based on the model of Madame Tussauds. And during Poli's time there, he worked with the gallery's historical wax collection, and he was able to really hone his craft in modeling from sketches and photographs. He did kings, he did queens, presidents, and he even constructed things like a chamber of horrors in there. He did a life-size Life of Christ exhibit. The Musée Grévin is still in operation today, not with Poli's exhibits, obviously, but you could still go in there today and really get a sense of what it was like in Poli's era and what he did to actually learn his craft. But by 1881, Sylvester had left Europe for America. And he arrived in New York at Castle Garden. So this is where I alluded a little bit at the beginning of this presentation. Castle Garden was the precursor to Ellis Island. It closed in 1890. So Poli actually arrived in the United States before massive waves of Italian immigration. Italian immigration in the United States peaked between about 1900 and 1915, according to some sources. And Sylvester came before all of that happened. So when you see Castle Garden, it's actually kind of a particular piece to the Italian immigrant story because not a lot of Italians really came through there, but Sylvester did. And again, like I said, he was from Northern Italy. I work for the Italian American podcast. I'm their associate producer. And this past week and the week before, we actually released a series about Northern Italian immigration to the United States because it's such an unheard of almost thing. Not a lot of Northern Italians really came to the United States. There are Northern Italian enclaves, but they're few and far between. So Sylvester Poli is actually one major example of Northern Italians in the United States. So if you get a chance to definitely check out those episodes of our show. So when Poli arrived in New York, he took a job with the Eden Musée. So it's kind of like the Musée Grévin, but the American version of it. It opened up in 1884, and it was a wax museum, much in the style of Madame Tussaud's Musée Grévin. It featured lifelike images of, at the time, Queen Victoria, President Chester Arthur, and it was also the place where Sylvester Poli came into contact with theatrical staging. So this is huge, because Poli really made his mark on the world of vaudeville. This is where that seed was planted into his brain at this Eden Musée in New York City. The museum included what was called a winter garden, and it was a large music hall with this gallery of what was called stereopticons. They were a slide projector that combined two images to create a three-dimensional effect, or they would make one image dissolve into another. And then they would play instrumental music with these. So kind of like a precursor to an actual film. There were small tables there, so this way visitors could rest and partake in light refreshments as all of this was going on around them. And that's really where Sylvester kind of got these ideas for his future fabulous career. In 1886 were the Haymarket riots. And by this point, we know that Sylvester was working for Philadelphia's Egyptian Museum as its chief modeler. So again, another museum like Madame Tussaud's, the Musée Grévin, Eden Musée, this Egyptian museum was along those same lines. He was the chief modeler. The Haymarket riots took place in Chicago that year. They were the aftermath of a bombing that took place at a labor demonstration that May at Haymarket Square in Chicago. And basically, it was a peaceful rally in support of workers who were striking for an eight-hour workday. It was the day after police killed one and injured several workers. So what Sylvester did was he secured permission from authorities and the families of the prisoners who were arrested during this to reproduce them in wax using their real clothes. And he opened up a store show with these figures and then took this exhibit on the road, giving exhibitions in various cities. And that was like his first foray into the world of theatrical exhibits. He was trying to do it more of a journalistic thing because he was giving news of the era, but it was really his first foray into that because he was actually trying to reproduce the Haymarket riots in his own way with these beautiful sculptures that he did. He entered into a partnership and then he opened combination theaters and museums in Toronto as well as in parts of New York. So that again is another way how he moved forward with his career. He married his wife, Rosa, in 1885, and by all accounts, it is because of her that Sylvester Poli was really able to take off and become the man that he became. The two of them met in New York City. At the time, Rosa was 16 years old, and she had just arrived in the United States from Genoa. So again, a Northern Italian meeting up with another Northern Italian. The two got married in 1885, and they were really the great loves of each other's lives. She's the one who told Sylvester that he should stop traveling with his sculptures and open up a storefront in New Haven, Connecticut, which is where they had settled. Before this, Poli was going door to door in New Haven, just selling wax statues of animals or saints or whatever people asked him to do. But Rosa felt that he was more talented than that. And she thought that he should really create the sculptures of famous people or notorious people and sell them. And he took that idea to heart and opened up a combination storefront, museum, and studio that eventually became Poli's Eden Musée. And Rosa stayed out front and she would sell and do what she needed to do while he was in the back creating the sculptures. And Sylvester actually taught her how to sew hair onto the sculpted figure's head so this way they would look more lifelike. After he became super successful, he actually bought the Villa Rosa mansion in New Haven and named that for her. And you can actually go to that compound today. There's several mansions on there. It's all privately owned, very, very expensive properties because it's right on the waterfront, but it's beautiful if you see pictures of it. So now we get into Sylvester as the builder of palaces because he had Rosa telling him, this is really what you should be doing. As time went on, he realized that he needed a theater where he could stage all of these beautiful high-class shows that he was in the process of creating with these sculptures. He ended up opening Poli's Wonderland Theater in 1893, and realizing how many people were gravitating to his theaters, he decided that he was just going to keep opening them throughout the entire Northeast section of the United States. So Connecticut, Massachusetts, New Jersey, Pennsylvania. The furthest south that he went was to Washington, D.C., and some cities had as many as three theaters, and he would often knock them down and rebuild them or gut them and rebuild them just so he could stay competitive in the field. And right here is a listing of all of his theaters going from 1892 to 1926. So you can see that there are a lot of different theaters there, some that you're probably familiar with, some that you're just like, oh wow, I didn't realize that there that town had a theater, but there's a lot of really great ones there. The ones that I'm highlighting in this presentation are ones that are either very significant to Sylvester Poli's story or they're ones that are still standing. So keep that in mind as you're listening to this, because obviously we can't highlight every single one of those. I wish that we could. Some of them don't even have photos in existence, unfortunately. So the one that I want to begin with is Poli's Palace in New Haven, Connecticut. And my reason for obviously highlighting New Haven is because that's where he settled. So this building that you see actually housed Poli's theatrical enterprises and other professional offices pertaining to arts and culture on the upper floors. This one was built in 1905 across the street from Poli's Wonderland that I had mentioned. And it's the first theater that he built from the ground up. So before this, it was just an empty lot, and he took that over and built this beautiful building. This picture is from 1908, and the building, like I said, to stay competitive, was actually gutted and reopened in 1917, and it had seating for 3,005 people. In 1939, after Mr. Poli passed away, unfortunately, Mickey Rooney and Judy Garland actually performed on the stage there, and definitely showing just how important these theaters have become to the theater world. It had a molar organ and a marble staircase, and that marble staircase actually led you to the Poli Theatrical Enterprises offices. And the next one is ours, for those of us that are here from Northeastern Pennsylvania. This is what the Ritz in downtown Scranton used to look like. And if you recall back to that image that I showed you that was taken by the drone, before, where I said you make note of that white part, this is what the white part was. So back in the back there, you can actually see the white part where it was obviously the new facade built over that. So Sylvester Poli opened the Poli Theater on Scranton, Wyoming Avenue on September 2nd, 1907, and it cost $250,000 to build. So that's about $6,700,000 in today's dollars. According to accounts, builder Frank Rica lost about $30,000, which would be about $750,000 on the project because of the constant changes. Sylvester Poli was known for being very particular about what his theaters looked like, and it was not an uncommon thing for him to just keep editing until he got it right. He was a consummate perfectionist when it came to his theaters. So it kept holding up the development of it because he kept changing his mind so much. And at the time of its opening, the Poli in downtown Scranton was considered one of the finest show houses in the nation. It seated about 2,000 people, and it contained a lower floor, a mezzanine, and a first and second floor balcony. Admission was 10 cents, which is $2.50 today, and the shows were held on afternoons and evenings. And what you're going to see here, I wish that when my Leadership Lackawanna team was doing our project that we could have afforded to buy this to be a part of the exhibit at the Ritz Theater Building in downtown Scranton, but unfortunately, this costs $400. And yes, that is one penny. These are the Poli penny. And they were when Sylvester Poli was opening his theaters, he would give these to people as they came in as a little token of the fact that they went to the grand opening. So one of these is going for about $400 on eBay today. So at least we have a photo so you can actually see what it looked like. And I thought it was pretty cool. The Scranton Times actually in the articles about this theater opening actually made mention that people walked away with a Poli penny. So I thought that was a cool thing to add to the presentation. Sarah Farley Allen worked in Scranton for 12 years in the early 1900s, illustrating advertisements and program covers for the Poli Theater, as well as newspapers and fraternal organizations. Sylvester discovered her while she was working in Scranton, and he used her work throughout his chain. Her studio was next door to the Poli Theater on Wyoming Avenue, and for 3 years she worked for him. She was illustrating and letter program covers and newspaper ads for Poli Summer Stock Company productions, as well as for vaudeville, minstrel, and comedy acts that were at the theater. And all of her program covers were drawn, brushed, and lettered in black on a heavy whiteboard in Art Nouveau style, and her advertisements employed a variety of styles. So you could just see two examples of her work there. Very talented woman, and she's able now to be a major part in Sylvester Poli's history, as well as Italian-American history in general, though she was not Italian, because of the fact that she was so closely intertwined with Poli's theater enterprises. So after Sylvester Poli sold his Pennsylvania theater chain to the Comerford theater chain in 1925, the Poli Theater ended up being closed in downtown Scranton in 1929. It ended first-rate vaudeville performances in Scranton with its closure. The remodeled and renamed Ritz Theater that we all know and love today opened on October 6, 1930. And Comerford Theaters operated that building as the Ritz until 1937, when they decided to completely rebuild it. So as you can see here in this photo, they really gutted the place. And that's why I brought you back at the beginning of this presentation to that original image, because what you see today is not what Sylvester Poli's original vision for the building was. But I want to call note to the proscenium in the background. If you look very carefully in that middle part, like you see the cars and then just look up into that middle empty part, you can see like a U-shaped arch. That's the original proscenium that is in the Ritz building. And if you go there today, when the Ritz Theater and Performing Arts Center / Kappa was doing renovations, they actually uncover the original proscenium. So there's a big chunk of that that's still intact. Unfortunately, they can't get it out of there. They can't really do anything with it because of where it is. And there's pieces of it that are falling apart. But if you go, you could actually see this. It's in the building and still there. So when they were renovating it to make it into the Comerford and then eventually back into the Ritz, they covered it up and eventually it was found again. It's way up high. It's up into the rafters of the theater. But you can go back there and actually see it. And I am sure that the Melcher family would be very happy to show you that as well. So now we're leaving Scranton. I'm taking you to Worcester, Massachusetts. And again, I want you to pay close attention to that U-shaped arch where you see the grand sign, because you're going to see it in several lifetimes in the next couple of slides. So Poli's Grand is in Worcester, Massachusetts, and it originally opened in 1904 as the Franklin Square Theater. And Poli purchased the building in 1909, and he completely remodeled it, renamed it the Grand, and it continued to show silent movies. He got Thomas W. Land, that I mentioned at the beginning, in 1926 to actually go back in and renovate the theater. He doubled the seating capacity there to 3,500. Because by this point, the talkies were just taking over and everybody was flocking to the theater. So Sylvester Poli wanted to make sure that people had seats in his theaters. So this way they weren't going to the competition. Lamb was able to transform the building into a complete palatial showcase, is what the historic records said, including a two-story lobby with mirrored walls, marbleized columns, an ornate grand staircase, and an immense chandelier in the main auditorium. So when people were going in to see these movies, they also were greeted with a beautiful experience, hearkening back to his days at the Musée Grévin, the Eden Musée, and in Philadelphia as well, where he really learned the staging and this whole idea of providing a full experience to people. After Sylvester Poli sold his New England holdings to Fox New England Theaters for $30 million in 1927, he retained 3/4 interest in the company and created Fox Poli's. And as a result of the stock market crash in 1929, Fox went into receivership in 1932. Poli ended up regaining control, and in May of 1934, Lewes Theaters purchased the remaining ones, and they became known as Lewes Poli's New England Theaters. So you could see the Grand under that. And if you look off to the left, you'll actually be able to see that original arch that I told you to pay attention to. And here we are today. And it's the Hanover Theater today. So what was once the Grand was purchased by Sumner Redstone and Redstone Theaters in 1967. They opened it as Showcase Cinemas and continued its operations as a multi-screen movie house until the late 1990s. And in 2002, ownership was transferred to the nonprofit Worcester Center for the Performing Arts. After extensive fundraising efforts and building community support, the theater opened in March of 2008 and renamed the Hanover Theater for the Performing Arts after the theater's corporate sponsors, Hanover Insurance, donated the seed money to get this whole thing renovated and really brought back to part of its old splendor. Today, it has the seating capacity for 2,300 people, so not quite the capacity that it had under Sylvester Poli, but it hosts nationally known entertainers, Broadway touring companies, much like the Scranton Cultural Center does here in Scranton. The building itself was added to the National Register of Historic Places in January of 2011. And if you look far back to the left, beyond those little flags that say Broadway and Music, you're going to see the original arch that you saw in those other two photos that I showed. So they really tried to keep it as close as they could architecturally and just really build it out for modern audiences, but still pay respect to the history of the building. And the Hanover Theater and the Ritz Theater are the only two of Poli's theaters in the United States that are still in operation under what they were originally meant to be. So it's pretty cool that we have that history right here in our own backyard. I always say to people though that Sylvester Poli, if he walked into the Hanover or into the Ritz, he would not recognize them because of all the extensive renovations that have gone on over the years. But I think he would be really happy just to know that these, you know, they were his babies almost, are still in existence today. And as I said, most of Poli's theaters were not so lucky. So what you're seeing right here is the Bijou Theater in New Haven, Connecticut. This was considered one of the crowning jewels of his chain. And Bijou actually means jewel in French. This was eventually torn down and a vacant lot is where it once was. There's a picture of it during demolition. And people really were upset about that. Most of his theaters are either demolished or abandoned properties, like we saw with that Majestic in Bridgeport. There's even people who are really convinced that these theaters are haunted. In fact, our Ritz in Scranton does a haunted Ritz tour. They think that maybe some ghosts are hanging out in these buildings, but especially in the abandoned ones. One of the websites I was reading when I was researching Sylvester Poli even said that one of the excavators that was in there that was trying to figure out how to tear down one of these buildings ended up falling from the stairs. And the guy said that he felt someone push him from behind. So these ghosts really don't want the buildings torn down. And I have to say thank you, ghosts, because when they're torn down, they're tearing down history. And I don't like that when people tear down history. Right now, I want to tell you a little bit about Poli's players. So Sylvester Poli, he really believed in giving people a chance and giving people a shot, because if it wasn't for that French sculptor that taught him back in the day when he was younger, he would never have made it to where he ended up going. So he wanted to give that same opportunity to as many people as possible. So many of today's show business legends actually got their start performing in Poli's vaudeville shows. But he himself was really careful about what he presented because he always wanted everything to have a moral undertone. So his shows were always very clean. They weren't the raunchy vaudeville shows that sometimes end up being a stereotype. His were very clean, very proper, very appropriate. The Poli players were his own stock performing troupe with lead actor Alfred Swenson. And according to records from the Scranton Board of Trade, the Poli Theater had such a gigantic impact on the city of Scranton's economy, with performers renting properties and spending their salaries locally. One performer alone averaged a spend of $3,000 annually, which is about $39,000 today, just in gowns, costumes, lingerie, shows, and other things necessary for a good stage presentation. Poli himself actually invited Harry Houdini to Scranton, and it was in Scranton that Houdini launched his legendary Chinese water torture trick. And he toured that around Poli theaters just so people could see that. But it began right here in our own backyard. And sometimes the theaters were even sites for religious services, such as one held in Scranton by Billy Sunday. Billy Sunday was an American evangelist originally from Iowa who began his career as a professional baseball player. Joan Crawford performed under her birth name of Lucia LeSueur in vaudeville shows for Sylvester Poli. She even performed right here in Scranton on the stage at the Ritz before she became Joan Crawford. And George Burns and Gracie Allen also performed for Poli and also performed in Scranton. In fact, Burns is partly responsible for that saying, if you can play Scranton, you can play anywhere, because our audiences here in Scranton had very, very discriminating tastes. And these were linked to the long days that they spent laboring in our coal mines or our labor yards. And because performing arts were the escape for these people, they refused to accept anything subpar. If you had a lousy performance, they were going to boo you. And George Burns felt that Scranton was such a great place to break in his new material that he would come here to test his new routines even after his association with Poli ended. Another really cool Poli story is about the four Cohens. Young George M. Cohen of Your Grand Old Flag Flame felt that their act was worth more than what Sylvester Poli was willing to pay. So after a lot of haggling, the Cohen brothers decided to keep their old salary and they went on stage. And during that particular performance, Cohen's parents were in the audience. They were celebrating their 25th wedding anniversary. And at the end of this performance, the house lights were raised and ushers came down the aisle carrying an elaborate silver serving set. And they were presented, the service set was presented to the older Cohens with congratulations from the Poli family. And after the show, the Poli family actually gave the Cohen parents a grand reception. And George actually pulled Sylvester Poli aside and was like, why are you doing this for my parents after you made such a fuss over the salary? And Sylvester said, listen, George, the salary was business. This gift is for friendship. So Sylvester knew how to split business and friendship. And of course, whenever I give a presentation about Italian, I have to talk about Italian things. So Sylvester Poli, in my opinion, again, he is an unsung hero in Italian-American history, and we're trying to make him a sung hero now with the thanks of the Lackawanna Historical Society, as well as other organizations that have really banded together and embraced Sylvester Poli. Sylvester, unfortunately, had to deal with a lot of discrimination in the United States because he was Italian. He was an immigrant. And you know, as immigration really took hold in the United States, there was this anti-Italian sentiment that came, and he bore the brunt of that. And the strongest example of anti-Italian sentiment for Sylvester Poli actually came from the Scranton Times, from the articles that I read. So thank you, Scranton Times, for the hometown. And it just says, Mr. Poli is an Italian. He was born in the land of sunshine and citrus a half century ago, but emigrated to America in 1881. Since then, nearly all traces of his European origin have been lost, and he would be well taken for a well-bred American. These type of things infuriated Sylvester Poli because he felt that as an Italian and as an American, because he did get American citizenship, that both countries were important to him. And the cool thing is, in New Haven, he was kind of considered one of the town elders and a really big mover and shaker in New Haven. He was part of the New Haven Civic Improvement Committee, and this is his response to people calling him out and making fun of him for being Italian. And he said, our race has found a sure refuge behind the stars and stripes, and we feel that among all her sons who are striving to carry this banner to victory, none will bring enthusiasm more steadfast loyalty than her sons of Italian blood. So he knew that he may be looked upon as a little different because he was Italian, but he was going to say that both countries meant the world to him, and he did. He is beloved in Bolognana, he's well known in Lucca, and here in the United States too, we would not have the motion picture industry as it is today without him. He was named a Chevalier of the Crown of Italy by King Victor Emmanuel III in 1915. His wife Rosa was also recognized for their contributions to Italy and to bringing the name of Italy to such a high prominence worldwide. And this is the highest civilian honor that the Italian government gives. And his legacy. To me, his legacy is, of course, the theaters. This is something that you just, when you walk into the Ritz Theater building in downtown Scranton, you get a sense of everything that went on there. And it's very, very powerful. And when Sylvester Poli ended his career and went into retirement, you're going to actually hear, hopefully if the sound sharing works on this, it's my first time trying it, this wonderful editorial by Charles B. Driscoll. And at the time, Charles B. Driscoll was one of the big journalists of his era. And you know that you had to be doing something right with your career if someone like that was writing an editorial about you. So to conclude, I want you to just listen to that wonderful editorial.
Sylvester Poli recently sold his New England group of theaters to a Boston syndicate for nearly $30 million. Mr. Poli is getting along in years now, and he thinks $30 million will keep the wolf from the door for the rest of his life, what with this and that in the way of other assets he has accumulated. Mr. Poli is another of those immigrants. He was born in Italy, where he was a sculptor's apprentice. He came to America when he was 22 years old. You might think that a young Italian sculptor's apprentice, arriving in America at the age of 22, without any knowledge of the American language and customs, would be handicapped. A handicap is something to make an ambitious horse put forth his best efforts to beat his competitors. I've known humans who, immediately upon recognizing the fact that they were handicapped in some way, begin to cry and to say that they must quit the race forthwith. Sylvester Poli wasn't that kind. If he had been, he would not be selling out now for $30 million. Handicaps never bothered Poli. They made him strive the harder.
And that's everything. I just want to say thank you very much. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you very much, Stephanie. That was excellent. Thank you for helping to sing the praises of Poli. So he's no longer quite as unsung, perhaps, as he was. I never saw that photo of the original theater in Scranton. So that was great to see. I will unmute everybody and we can take a few questions here. I'm going to turn off your screen sharing too, Stephanie.
Well, yes, first of all, I thought it was a great program. Really enjoyed it and learned, like everyone else, about an individual, an unsung hero. You know, that was really nice.
Thank you. I have to thank the Lackawanna Historical Society too, because when we got assigned this Poli gallery, our first thought was, what are we going to do? How are we going to find out all this information? And Marianne and Sarah were so amazing with the help. So they kind of helped create the monster that you see today with this obsession with Sylvester Poli, because that's all that I do when I get a chance now is looking up things about him so I could discover more.
Yeah, it was a great job. Wow.
To go down, Stephanie, that's fine.
That was so nice. I liked it.
Did the sound sharing work?
It did.
Sorry, what?
Perfectly.
Oh, good.
Great. Did they have any children?
They did. That mausoleum that you saw at the end, very unfortunately, their oldest son actually died of tuberculosis, and he was the one that was being groomed to take over the theater empire. And he was buried in that mausoleum. And Sylvester was never really the same again after that. So he ended up selling the holdings. He also had several daughters. One of his daughters ended up marrying a very high ranking official in Italy and spent a lot of time going back and forth between the two.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Interesting.
Stephanie, thank you for this. This is Rick. This is my first introduction to Sylvester Poli was through a woman named Arlene Fritz, who I found while researching Underwood Village. It was part of the Underwood Mine Complex, an Oliphant and Troop. And she mentioned in her paper that when they go to Scranton via the electric trolley from Troop, that after hitting the sales, the drastic sales, as she called them, at the stores, they always ended their shopping trip with a vaudeville show at Poli's. This is the first time I'm seeing the actual facade, a picture of the theater that they actually attended. This is like really, really striking. The other thing for me is when you showed the shot of Castle Garden, you said it closed in 1890. My great-grandfather on my dad's side came to the United States in 1897 from what's now the Czech Republic. And he came through Castle Garden in 1897, as I said, 3 years before it closed. So thanks for that shot. I've never seen that before. This is absolutely great. The only other thing I thought, because I'm down here in New York, I go to Jersey City a lot, which is right across the river. And I immediately thought, is Poli still standing in Jersey City? But apparently it isn't. Because I was just there yesterday. And I mean, I'd go back over just to have a look at it. But thanks. This has been absolutely awesome. I really appreciate it.
Oh, it's my pleasure. If you want to, the Historical Society, I'm sure, would be happy to share my contact information. And if you want any of the photos that I had in this, I'm more than happy to email them to people. Or you can even get me off my website, stephanielongo.net. And I'm always happy to share what I have with everybody. I think that it's important to do so. I wouldn't be where I am if people didn't share with me. So
thank you so much.
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you, Stephanie.
Okay, cool. Wow.
That's good.
Stephanie?
Yes.
I was in Scranton between 98 and 2011. I never got to the Ritz Theater. Are there activities? Does anything happen there anymore?
Yes, so I did not get into this into the presentation just for interest of time, but in the 1990s, you're probably remembering what it was like when it was the Dollar Theater. I went there as a kid to see Sister Act and The Little Mermaid, so that's like my memories of the Ritz. It was vacant for about 20 years after that, and the Creative and Performing Arts Academy of Northeastern Pennsylvania actually took it over. They're renovating parts of the building as we speak. They have staged theatrical productions as well as films and a lot of different community events. So you could go there. Our exhibit from Leadership Lackawanna was part of like phase one of their renovations. And you could go in there and see a lot of the photos that we did and a lot of the other stories that I couldn't fit into this presentation. And a lot of the photos came from the Historical Society as well. So we're always, I can't say it enough. I'm so thankful to you guys.
It'd be nice to do a little booklet on it.
You're not the first person who has told me to do that. And it's something that I definitely want to do. It's funny, there is a documentary in Italian out about Sylvester Poli. I've been in touch with the filmmaker just to like compare and contrast notes. And if I did something, it would be the only one in the United States and in the English language. So it's like, okay, I got to do this. Where do I find the time?
Okay, that's only at the time.
Yeah, but I have had publishers interested in using some of the research. So it's a matter of sitting down and deciding how I want to proceed with it.
Thank you, Stephanie. It was wonderful.
Oh, thank you.
And there's a next project for you coming up again to write the book about Poli.
Well, you know, I'll be the first buyer.
It's crazy because I have so many projects going on. I'm also doing research on Parodi cigars in Scranton. I'm doing a lot of extensive research on them for a project, and that's taking up all of my free time. So I find myself like going between Sylvester and Parodi, Poli and Parodi, Poli and Parodi. It just depends which one I'm doing. Two peas in a pod. It's all Italian.
the locals, I've always heard it referred to as the Poli. Is that what the locals called it?
It's the Scranton accent, the proper pronunciation of his name. I actually I slipped. I'll tell you a funny story. When I presented this presentation in Boston, I slipped and I called it the Poli. And a lovely Italian person in the audience said to me, but I thought you had a degree in Italian. I said, I did, but I'm from Northeastern Pennsylvania and sometimes it just comes right out.
Well, the I is pronounced E in Italian.
Yes.
So it would be Poli.
It would be Poli. Yep.
Yeah, but here we pronounce it Poli. A lot of people in Northeastern Pennsylvania just, I guess, with our accent or how he might have even Americanized it.
Right?
Exactly. He may have even Americanized his own pronunciation. So.
Well, that's true.
Yeah.
Well, Richard and I will call him Poli.
I think this is happy
in my last name. The I is an E, Matarazzi, and it's I at the end.
I think Sylvester would be happy as long as somebody actually remembers him. I think that's the cool part of it all.
But he was brilliant.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to equate the 30 million into today's value, what it would be. Yeah. I wouldn't even want to think.
Yeah. Let me see.
Stephanie, did you have any photographs or find any work of his sculpture? Did you actually see any of his wax work?
No, and that's one thing that I'm interested in finding, but I'll tell you another curiosity. So again, up in Boston, a woman came up to me after this presentation, and she is convinced that that town of Bolognana is like this hub for Italian sculptors near Lucca, except that the sculptors that she was referring to came after Poli, so I'm not entirely sure what the connection is there. She sent me articles and everything, and I'm just like, I'm not seeing it when I read these things, but I want to try to dive into that a little bit more, because if that's something in the water in that town, that's kind of cool for that story. Everybody that I've asked, they've said that his sculptures have just been lost to time, unfortunately, but you never know what's out there. The weird thing is that things are discovered at random. Even in the Ritz Theater building, recently they told me that they found the old tapestries that used to hang. They're from the Poli era. So you never know what somebody has lurking around their basements. You just don't know what's out there. So I'm hoping that somebody someplace, who knows, maybe family members have that and they just don't want to give it up.
Just amazing.
All right, well, thank you very much, Stephanie. We'll have the video of this presentation on our YouTube channel and our Facebook page probably Monday or Tuesday next week. Again, watch your email and our Facebook again for the program next week. Maureen Hart will be joining us as the guest presenter. She will kick off what is traditionally wedding season with a program about wedding dresses through time. So we did trolleys last week. Now we're into theaters. We're moving right into weddings and fashion next week. So tune in again next Friday. We hope to see you all then. Have a good weekend. And again, wash your hands.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.